Thinking about systems under stress and the things humans do and the things that are going on in sort of more the natural realm, that's one of our greatest challenges, is to look at the intersection, to think about how do we continue our existence? How do we have a planet that we can have our cake and eat it too, where people don't have to deal with famines and people don't have to go hungry and people can live these happy lives while at the same time we're maintaining high levels of biodiversity. Trying to manage all of those things is really complicated, especially as population keeps going up, especially as, you know, we think inside of our own ethnic boundaries and we're, you know, not spanning enough in those dimensions.
There are so many, in my area, so many big mega catastrophes that have been unfolding across the nation and around the world, that it feels like really thinking about how do we move across disciplinary boundaries, how do we move across research to practice to policy boundaries, that these are just such crucial questions for our individual disciplines, for interdisciplinary work, and for our practice and our policy. So making research actionable, it all just feels so important.
You know, one of the things we face when we're trying to cross, you know, span boundaries or trying to be interdisciplinary are methodological. How do we bring together really different toolkits from, say, archaeology, the field I work in, or sociology or biology or whatever we're working with? One of the neatest things I saw was in the session on emerging infectious diseases. They were showing how you could look at diseases, in this case it was Zika they were trying to follow, and they were trying to look at the vectors and how Zika moved it, where it came from. And one of their biggest challenges had always been following those vectors. You know, you can get flight logs from planes and things like that, but what they had done was use the geolocation tools in Twitter to actually track the movements of people and also potentially diseases in a much more fine-grained way than ever before. That was one of the most novel things I'd seen.
If you want to span research or disciplinary boundaries, you need those collaborators. And oftentimes, individuals know what type of collaborator they need, in the sense of, I need this kind of information or understanding, but they either have no idea who those people might be, or they even don't recognize that there's entire disciplines in other fields that have been championing a particular area of research.
Some of the things that we're trying to build in the hazards and disaster community to connect to the socio-ecological synthesis community to respond to some of these challenges that we're seeing in both of our communities is to identify, collect information, and ultimately map researchers. Who's in our social science hazards and disaster community? What we could do with this information is we could say, this is where all the social scientists are within a particular radius of a disaster. We could also then add different layers into this platform so we could look at researchers by academic discipline, and then use GIS as a tool to coordinate researchers in the event of a disaster. We can't connect the dots if we don't know where people, the dots are.
One of the big opportunities that is going to come out of this meeting is just that it is bringing together so many different scholars from so many different disciplines who are all deeply concerned with these questions of how do we connect around socio-environmental synthesis challenges and issues, but also how do we take what we know and make it actionable.